So there'll be 15 neuro questions, and let's start with the first one here on your screen. MRI finding depicted on this image may be seen with all except. So the question is all except. So I saw most of you chose option A, but later on you saw that word all except. So extrapontine myelinolysis, flavivirus encephalitis, Wernicke's or Wilson's. So this is something very easy. We all revise it often. T2, basal ganglia, symmetric hyperintensity and their differentials. So 37% have said C, and then again there is a divide. So let's see what the answer is. It's C. So it can be seen with extrapontine myelinolysis, flavivirus encephalitis and Wilson's, but this kind of appearance of T2 hyperintensity in basal ganglia is not common with Wernicke's encephalopathy. So this is a list of differential of T2 hyperintensity in basal ganglia. Ischemia, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, venous infarction, we already saw. Autoimmune encephalitis, CJD, extrapontine myelinolysis. Toxins like carbon monoxide, cyanide neurotoxicity. Almost any kind of viral encephalitis can lead to this picture. And even lymphoma can cause it. But what do we see in Wernicke? We see it as T2 flare hyperintensities which are symmetrical, but they are in the areas of mammillary body, which we saw today in the anatomy talk, dorsomedial thalamide, pectal plate, periaqueductal gray matter, and around the third ventricle. So now this is the second question on your screen, and you can see the images, sagittal T2, post contrast T1 and axial. And these are your options on the screen. What is your possible diagnosis?
Patient who is a 47-year-old male and has complaints of acute onset upper limb tingling and numbness.
Right, so we have received a lot of responses. And let's see what it is. So it is 42% of you feel it is hemangioblastoma, and 13% are thinking of B. 16% for tuberculomas also. So what is this? It's a 47-year-old male gentleman, and the diagnosis for this case is hemangioblastoma. So what we saw here was a lesion which is relatively hypo-intense on T2-weighted images and lot of perilesional edema. And it's a nodular enhancement which we are seeing. That what we are not identifying is that there is no obvious large cystic component, no obvious hemorrhagic area. And anything which will be there in the spinal cord will always cause lot of edema or disproportionate edema because of the fact that spinal cord is a small area, is a constricted space. So spinal hemangioblastomas are the third most common intramedullary spinal neoplasm, representing 2 to 6% of all intramedullary tumors. So they should be thought as a differential whenever fits into. And their age group is 40 to 50 years of age. Mostly you see like discrete nodules. Sometime there will be syringes or cyst associated with them, and the most common location is the thoracic cord. Great. Now this is another differential question on your screen, and the options are also there, so we can start the poll. MRI findings depicted on this image can be seen with all except. So there is a finding. These are diffusion and axial flare images, and you have to identify what all can cause it, but the answer has to be the one which cannot cause this particular finding. So we have received the responses, but a lot of confusion in there. So, but 29% think that it is the option D, which is methanol toxicity. So let's see what this entity is and what is the answer. The answer to this question is methanol toxicity, and this is called as the cytotoxic lesion of the corpus callosum, also called as the transient splenial hyperintensity. And we have a lot of causes for this, like seizures can also, that's just a postictal thing. So it is most of the time confused with infarct. Restricted diffusion may make you think that it's a small infarct, but the location and flare hyperintensity and clinical correlation makes it easier. So it can be post epilepsy or post seizure, metabolic disturbances like electrolyte imbalance, infections, CNS malignancies,
Drugs and toxins can also lead to this. Even a subarachnoid hemorrhage sometime can cause this to happen. But methanol toxicity will not cause this finding commonly. Here, that time we see bilateral basal ganglia changes. So now let's move to the next question. And this is the question with options on your screen. There are sagittal T2 and T1 weighted images, and you have to identify what this condition is. So 36% of you think that this is metastasis, and then 37% have diagnosed it as Kummel's. So this was Kummel's. So this is an entity where we have the osteonecrosis of the bone, and you have delayed vertebral body collapse due to ischemia and non-union of the anterior vertebral bodies with wedge fractures after major trauma. These are not metastasis, but where you can see that even the posterior margins are not convex. There is wedging of these vertebrae. They are not homogeneously hypointense on T1 weighted images, and on T2 you can also see this positive fluid sign, which is seen with osteoporotic fractures. So these are all osteoporotic fractures or traumatic fractures, and they have developed into bone infarcts or osteonecrosis. Next question is on your screen and with four options. So we can start the poll at the same time. 57-year-old gentleman with progressive bilateral facial nerve palsy, and all of them are the possible diagnosis except. So we have the result, and the maximum 47% votes are to the option number D, which is scleroderma, and that is the correct answer. So what we are seeing here on this image is that there are multiple cranial nerves which are involved, and they are thickened and they are enhancing. So we are dealing with a situation where we have multiple cranial nerve involvement, thickening, enhancement, and the differential to this is metastasis, neurofibromatosis type 2, lymphoma is an important one, leukemia, multiple sclerosis, CIDP, Lyme's is not very common in India, neurosarcoid and metachromatic leukodystrophy. So commonly seen are lymphoma, neurosarcoid, and maybe with metastasis, and also with paraneoplastic syndromes. But scleroderma will not cause any CNS symptoms. So that was the answer. Next question on your screen. This is a young male patient, 29-year-old, and he has complaints of headache and vomiting. And these are the images on your screen. You can see the images, and I'll take the slide to the option one also. This one is the slide with options. This colorful image which you are seeing is the perfusion, ASL, non-contrast perfusion, which we can perform and assess the areas of hyperperfusion within this lesion. This is post-contrast T1, pre-contrast T1. So most of you have identified it correctly as atypical central neurocytoma. So this is atypical central neurocytoma, and because of the location, because of the morphology, you can identify it correctly. So these are WHO grade 2 neuroepithelial intraventricular tumors with fairly characteristic imaging features, and they usually have heterogeneous appearance and heterogeneous post-contrast enhancement. Calcification is common and can be typically punctate. MR spectroscopy, where we saw a tall choline peak, also is a characteristic feature. Another set of images on your screen. Next question. So here you see a post-contrast axial T1. Diffusion and coronal T2. You see a lesion which is homogeneously enhancing, restricted diffusion and T2 hypointensity. This is the same patient where we have obtained a single voxel spectroscopy. So this is how this patient spectroscopy looked like, and these are your four options. All are true for this pathology except lipid peak is seen due to active presence of macrophages containing a strong rate of moving lipid, CT hypodense enhancing supratentorial mass, choline peak may be seen, restricted diffusion is a characteristic. So again, I'll show you the image. This is the finding, and these are the options. So we have the answers with us, and 34% of you feel that this is answer number C. 32% are towards answer option number B. So what is it? Choline peak may be seen and CT hypodense enhancing supratentorial mass. So first of all, we should diagnose what this situation is. This is primary CNS lymphoma, a lesion which is homogeneously enhancing, lesion which is showing restricted diffusion and is showing a tall choline peak. So this is your creatinine at 3.02. So this peak is your choline at 3.22. And you can see that the choline peak is above the creatinine peak, which should not be there. So this is the reversal of your Hunter's angle. So you definitely see elevated choline. So what are all these features suggestive of? These are suggestive of hypercellularity. So you have something which is hypercellular, densely packed cells are there, and that fits into lymphoma. So anything which will be densely cellular and which will be kind of densely packed cells will be present, then that has to look hyperdense on CT, not hypodense. Therefore, this option is correct. This option is the answer of the question. So you will see everything except a CT hypodense lesion. So that was the question. In primary CNS lymphomas, you can have typical hypointense T1 lesions which are showing restricted diffusion, and MR spectroscopy will show you choline peak, and along with the choline peak, because of these macrophages, you will also have a lipid lactate doublet peak. So that is a twin peak sign which is seen with lymphoma. So this is the next question on your screen. These are MRI images depicting acute and subsequent chronic changes in pediatric disease spectrum. So the question is not asking you the diagnosis. So these are three images of the same disease in acute phase, and these are the two in the same disease spectrum, different patient in later phase, chronic phase. So in this particular disease, the calvarial size changes. Whatever the diagnosis is, the calvarial size changes. So you have to choose one option where the size of the calvarium does not change similar to the change in this disease. So little tricky question, but you can attempt it easily. So the responses wise, the answer to the question you have given is C, glutaric aciduria type 1, which is the diagnosis in this situation. So that way you are correct, but the answer as per the question asked is D, fetal rubella syndrome. So what is it? This is glutaric aciduria type 1. So you see that there is a area of restricted diffusion and T2 hyperintensity with edema in bilateral basal ganglia. And later on, you can see that the sylvian fissures are widened out and these areas are smaller in size and basal ganglia T2 hyperintense. So this is glutaric aciduria type 1. What happens to the calvarium here? You get macrocephaly. So the size increases. So everything which can increase this skull size or macrocephaly related pathologies are congenital hydrocephalus, hydranencephaly, neurofibromatosis type 1, tuberous sclerosis, metabolic storage disorders, Alexander's, Canavan's, glutaric aciduria, Noonan's, but rubella, which is a part of your TORCH spectrum, TORCH infestation lead to microcephaly and not macrocephaly. So therefore, that was the answer. Now, this is your next question, the ninth question on your screen. You can choose your answers from the option box. So most of you feel that it is the second option, medulloblastoma, and that is the correct answer. The appearance is little odd, so there was some confusion, but this is medulloblastoma, which is the most common malignant brain tumor of the childhood. And just to revise, we have four types, that is your WNT, sonic hedgehog, and group 3 and group 4. So the ones which are in midlines, they can be group 3, group 4. Cerebellar hemisphere involvement is very likely with the sonic hedgehog variety, and therefore that has an intermediate prognosis. Whereas the cerebellar peduncles, when involved with the WNT subgroup, that has the best prognosis. Next question on your screen. So we can have the polling options. So here is a young person who has developed progressive soft swelling over the left frontal convexity, and the person is immunocompetent. So what is your diagnosis? Metastasis, osteosarcoma, aspergilloma or lymphoma? So we have the answers, and most of you feel it is aspergilloma. 41%, and then 27% feel it is osteosarcoma. So we have a CT image also, where you see that there is complete bone erosion. So this is a case of aspergilloma, where retrospectively we saw that this mass lesion was completely more or less hypointense on T2 weighted images and flare images, and also that there was complete osseous erosion on swan. There were areas of blooming which could correspond to the fungal hyphae and fungal byproducts. So aspergilloma can have various radiographic presentations, and they may be associated fungal ball or masses which can be slow growing, and they will cause osseous erosions like this. They can also cause involvement of the vessels, vasculitis and cerebral infarction. Next question on your screen, you have to identify the phenomena. So you have your polling options. So most of you have identified this phenomena correctly. So this is cross cerebellar diastasis. So this is something interesting. We had this in last year's quiz also. And you see this on ASL non-contrast perfusion image. There is a phenomena where one part of your cerebral hemisphere is hypoperfused and contralateral cerebellar hemisphere is hypoperfused. So this refers to depression in function, metabolism and perfusion affecting a cerebellar hemisphere occurring as a result of the contralateral focal supratentorial abnormality. So this patient had status epilepticus episode and this is a postictal change. So most likely the phenomena is due to interruption of the corticopontocerebellar white matter tract. This is the question on your screen. Identify the lesion. These are very commonly seen in the brain, but in the cord sometimes it's rare. So your polling options are on your screen, and you see sagittal T2 and sagittal T1 post contrast and axial post contrast. So 50% of you think it these are intramedullary tuberculomas, and that is the correct answer. So still 50% had some doubt related to this particular thing. So these are typical T2 hypointense lesions which are peripherally enhancing, and we see a lot of perilesional edema, conglomerate lesions. Spinal intramedullary tuberculomas are rare and most of the time secondary to the tubercular involvement elsewhere in the body. So this patient also had multiple tuberculomas in the brain and also there were pulmonary involvement. So this is the next case, fetal MRI, and you can start. And to this most of you have replied as A, vein of Galen, and then C, dural sinus malformation. So this is a fetal MRI with a large abnormal flow void, which is a vascular channel, but the location is not vein of Galen. So we have just seen the venous anatomy and revised it. So we know that vein of Galen malformation is somewhere here. So this is a dural sinus malformation, which has been partially thrombosed, and they are known to resolve also. So in fetal MRI, if you pick it up, or even on fetal ultrasound, if you pick it up, if you follow them, they will slowly reduce in size. So that is important to identify. Sometimes if they are thrombosed on ultrasound, people may think that these are posterior fossa masses. So this is not vein of Galen malformation. Another question, you have this phenomena of transsynaptic degeneration. Which tract is involved in this particular phenomena? So you have two sets of images and we are showing two abnormalities which are interrelated. So we have our polling answers and we see that 43% of you feel it is dentato-rubro-olivary pathway and next 38% is cerebello-olivary pathway. So this is something related to the olivary pathway. So this is hypertrophic olivary degeneration which is happening because of this cavernoma, and the pathway which is involved here is the dentato-rubro-olivary pathway, which is result in hypertrophy of the inferior olivary nucleus. So the parts are red nucleus, inferior olivary nucleus and the contralateral dentate nucleus. So this is something interesting. Last question for this quiz, identify the pathology. So we can start with the polling options. So we have already received over 100 responses and most of you feel that it is option number 2, syntilencephaly, which is the correct answer. So what is this syntilencephaly? So this is a spectrum in the entity of holoprosencephaly, and here you see middle interhemispheric variant, which is a mild subtype of holoprosencephaly that is characterized by an abnormal midline connection of the cerebral hemisphere between the posterior frontal and the parietal region. So this is something which is very similar to lobar holoprosencephaly, but the interhemispheric fissure is characteristically absent. The rest of the brain appears more or less normal structurally. And here you have appearance of a monoventricle due to fusion. So this is scintillanticferi. So thank you everyone. With this, we come to an end of this short quiz.